Hartlike welkom by Agri Monitor. Vanoggend is so koue liggie hier in Windhoek. Maar Tinus Pretorius, die voorsitter van die Namibiese Landbou-Unie, het vir ons 'n foto gestuur van daar uit die Otjiwarongo distrik waar hy boer, van ys op sy krip. Nou ja, ons sien die wolkies kom in so van Angola af, trek die vog af, so ons hoop regtig vir die beste. Maar ons boere bly ons altyd hoopvol. Vandag in ons program is Agribank se tegniese adviseur Erastus Ngaruka. Hy kom kuier by ons en vertel vir ons alles wat 'n boer moet doen voor, tydens en na die droogte. Hy gee baie interessante wenke. Vandag op ons voorblad is die Leyberig Rooivleis Gespreksforum met Suid-Afrika en Botswana. Baie dankie aan Theonista Kalman wat die voorblad vir ons so mooi uitgelê het. Dit lyk vir my pragtig. So in 'n onlangse vergadering tussen die Namibiese Lewende Hawe Produsente Organisasie, die LPO, die Suid-Afrikaanse Rooivleis Produsente Organisasie en die Gansie Boerevereniging van Botswana is belangrike sake oor die veebedryf rakende die drie lande bespreek. Suid-Afrika is in 'n kritieke mark vir Namibiese veeboere met 80% van die inkomste van skaapboere en 40% van beesboere wat afkomstig is van Suid-Afrikaanse verbruikers. Op bladsy 2 het advokaat Piet Harmse in sy Agri-Law rubriek meer inligting oor wetgewing en skoudiere gegee. Op bladsy 3, dit is omtrent nou skoutyd, dit is die Grootfontein skou, dit is die Gobabe skou en dan is dit die Windhoek skou. En 'n baie interessante kompetisie van Feedmaster en Bank Windhoek is die jeugbees beoordelaars. So die 21 finaliste is bekend gemaak. Daar is 'n hele paar van Gobabis Gymnasium, van die gekombineerde skool Okanjatu en van Moria en ook Elnathan Okamapati. So ek gaan al daai leerlinge gaan ek ontmoet en ek gaan nou kyk hoe beoordeel hulle 'n bees. Ek sien baie uit daarna. Op bladsy 4 is ons toerisme en omgewingsnuus en baie goeie nuus, internasionale nuus met Noiras wat 'n gesogte Michelangelo wyntoekenning ontvang het. Ek het al daar gaan kuier by Noiras. Dit is omtrent 'n belewenis om te sien hoe maak hulle wyn in die middel van die woestyn. En dan is daar ook goeie nuus oor 'n olifantkalfie in die Hoëpervier. Die mortaliteitssyfers van woestyn aangepaste olifante is baie hoog, maar hierdie jaar is daar nou al 2 wat oorleef het. So ons hoop vir die beste. And a warm welcome to Erastus Ngaruka, Technical Advisor at Agribank for Livestock and Rangeland. Welcome at Agri Monitor.
Thank you.
We've met each other so many times, yeah. Wherever we are in the field. I think the last time was the biomass fair.
Now
here you are.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for having me. Yeah, the sector is trying to come up with different projects and so forth. So we are meeting here and there. So the engagements are a lot now.
Yes.
Yeah, there are shows, there are expos, whatsoever. So
we are busy now.
We are busy
until the end of the year. This time is very busy,
yeah,
with all the shows.
We have to keep on networking, otherwise we'll lose focus in terms of information sharing. So we need to network and share information.
Okay.
Yeah.
We are amidst a terrible drought, and You have some tips for us, for farmers. How, what to do before a drought, during a drought, and after a drought, because there's a big difference. What do we do with our livestock?
All right, thank you. You know, Namibia has been enduring recurrent droughts, more especially since 2013, which was, I can say, the worst. But yeah, we are here still surviving, but under hardship conditions. So we just have to remember as farmers that it's not our first drought, it's not our last one. So probably we have to keep on preparing or be ready for any eventuality in terms of the climatic conditions. Yeah, so I remember years back, maybe even our grandfathers used to say every 7 years a drought year or such things. What are we saying currently?
Probably it's not like
every
that.
Year or every second year. Yeah, so as a farmer, that means every year you need to do an assessment on your farm. You need to assess yourself in terms of finances. Do you have finances to survive through drought? Do you have grazing, enough grazing land and enough grazing materials to survive through drought? So, and then every action that you are even taking, it has to be at the minimal costs. You have to make sure that you also don't spend a lot of money, but you try to maintain your livestock within your means as well. So every year you must assess yourself. Now, this assessment will help you to even plan. You need to have a plan before drought. What will you do if drought comes? So that is the biggest question that you need to ask yourself. What if? Yeah, so that you prepare and plan. And then during drought, again, there must be some strategies that you are employing to make sure that you survive through or withstand those conditions. And then after drought, there's also a plan. You know, you need to have a plan because at one point you need to come back to your potential, for example. Yeah, so before drought, you need to make sure that, yes, the plan talks about fodder for the animals, talks about the grazing. Have you spared enough grazing for those that have camps? Have you spared certain camps for difficult times? If you have money, have you saved enough money to buy supplements, for example? Or if you have you identified another grazing area? As we commonly say, I'm moving to the greener pastures.
Yeah, moving to greener pastures.
Yeah, but where is the greener pastures in Namibia if everyone is affected? So probably you need to have a plan for that as well, that if I have to move my animals, where do I go to? How long do I go stay there? And is there a reliable grazing and reliable water as well?
Yeah.
Because sometimes farmers just wake up and then run because they are desperate, they are in difficult times. So they end up in areas where there's difficulties now, poisonous plants and so forth. So everywhere, if you decide to relocate, you need to ask yourself, where am I going? How long? And is there reliable water and grazing as well? And then again, in terms of fodder, where will you source your fodder from?
Yeah.
And it's also nice to prepare well in advance to say, if drought comes, at least during that time, I must be able to take fodder from my own storage. So meaning during good times, you need to start storing fodder as well. And even buy supplements, because during good times, sometimes prices are much better, lower. So
you can,
start stocking up. Yeah. So in terms of fodder, and again, water. It's very important.
Water, I'm worried about the water situation.
It's a very big issue. The population is increasing. There's too much pressure on the boreholes. The animals, the numbers are a lot. And now that the animals are suffering from feed scarcity or grazing scarcity, they should not also suffer in terms of water. So you need to also make sure that you prepare your water sources. You need to rehabilitate if they are dilapidated. You need to rehabilitate your water, your boreholes, and you need to make sure that your storage capacities are also well prepared or big enough to even store enough water for the duration of the drought. And again, we need to store water. And I've seen in many farms, people don't store water, don't store enough water. Some they even pump directly from the borehole into the water trough animals drink. So if that bowl breaks, then what? So it's better to always use water from your reservoirs. Pump into the reservoirs and store them enough. Yeah, and again, in terms of finances, you need to ask yourself, where will you source the finances from? Is it from your own savings? Is it from your own farm sales? Or would you go to Agribank and borrow something? Maybe production loan to survive through the drought? So these are the plans that you need to do. And again, in terms of the effectiveness of your drought plan, it will depend on the time that you implement it. So sometimes I like to say delay is dangerous. So
it's dangerous. It is true.
Yeah. So the all these good plans that you may have, they may not work if you do not apply them on time. So for example, if you look at the current situation, farmers have been, they thought maybe the rainfall activities will improve the current season, the previous season. Maybe rain will come, or maybe the prices will
increase. Everybody thought last year would be a good rain season, and then it was all those cyclones in Northeast Africa.
And exactly. So we kept on hoping and praying that things will get better, but then look at the prices that we are selling our animals at. Yeah. In fact, the prices, March, April, where we expect better prices, the prices are very low. Yes. Or even the cattle that are still in good condition, we could not sell them because maybe the market was flooded.
Yeah.
So, yeah, because everyone, even the buyers, they know that I cannot buy more because I don't even have grazing, or maybe I've budgeted my grazing. Because as a farmer, you also need to budget your grazing. Mm. Yeah, how much do you have and how much do your animals need? How many animals can you keep there? So the effectiveness of your plan depends on the time that you employ it or implement it. So the earlier, the better. Yeah, and again, during drought, now you are into that situation. What do you do? Are you able to implement what you have planned? Mm. And what are you doing in terms of your livestock? So now this is now, you are playing your cards already now.
Yeah.
So which cards to release, which cards to hold on? Yeah, for example, when you look at the livestock, you know, if you look at your cattle in your corral, not all of them, they are not all the same.
No.
In terms of performance even. Mm. So there are some poor performers, there are those that are your best. Mm. So when you are playing your cards, you need to decide now, from which group do I maybe release or remove some to maybe sell or maybe move elsewhere? Mm. Yeah, because you have animals that are just filling spaces in your corral, that are even delaying reproduction. So in any delay into production means it's a delay in your income
as well.
Delay
is dangerous.
Delay is dangerous.
So you have to think very strategically.
Very much.
If you're a farmer, you have to be.
Yes.
Think very strategically.
Yeah. So then you need to select these animals that you now have to take out. Mm-hmm. And, maybe you can take them to somewhere else, or you are selling them, for example. So, but anything that you are selling as well, you need to prepare it. You need to make it beautiful, let it attract the buyer as well.
Yeah.
There are many farmers during drought, they just sell out of desperation to say, let me get rid of them.
Get rid of them.
And then what do they get in return? Mm. Remember, you have invested so much in that animal to bring it to that stage.
Yeah.
So you shouldn't just give it away like that. So any animal that you select to sell, also prepare it for the buyer, but also sell at the right time. Mm. So, and ask yourself, which ones do I sell? Where do I sell? Mm. When do I sell? So some farmers, they expect the best price. Sometimes there will be no best price.
Is it better to sell on auctions or privately?
Those are the assessments you need to do yourself.
Mm.
So where do I, because it's a business, so you also want your return on investment. Where would you get the best or the better money?
Yeah.
Is it at an auction? Where is that auction? Is it, how far is it from me? What other services am I? Maybe if you are in the Bukiro, you have to decide, do I sell in Hobabes?
Mm.
How far is it from me? What other services do I get from there? Or what are the prices, in fact?
Yeah.
Or do I sell here in the Bukiro itself, where there's no transportation cost, for example?
Mm. Because transport is also expensive.
Yes. But again, you have sold here, but again, you need to take this money, travel to Hobabes to go buy your fodder for your animals. So those are the judgments that you need to do. So, but the earlier the better. The price that is prevailing, that's the price. Go for it. If you are waiting and hoping and praying, you might not get what you want, because we are not in charge of the climatic conditions. So we don't know what is going on there. We are not in charge of rain. So what we have to ask ourselves is, these things that I have in my hands, my animals, how do I make sure that they survive until I receive the next drop of rain, for example?
Yeah.
So now farmers think of rain, and they forget to take care of their animals.
Yeah.
They're just thinking about the rain. So, and again, during drought, farmers spend a lot of money buying animal fodder and leaf supplements. Sometimes they buy the wrong ones, and also buying for the wrong animals. So it's better to make sure you understand the products, you understand your grazing conditions, and also look at your animal condition. What do they need? And at what production stage are they? Do you have lactating ones? Is it dry cows? Is it young ones growing? And so forth. Because these animals will have different needs and they will require different supplements, for example. So as a farmer, you need to also do that mini research at your own, at your disposal to say, yes, I have my lactating cows. For them to produce enough milk, which products do I buy? Is it cow and cow flake, for example? Or what mixes do I have to come up with? Then you consult with the experts, Feedmaster, and even your neighbors who are experienced, for example. Yeah, so, and separate the animals as well. You know, you cannot feed a lactating cow with a dry cow. Two different animals, two different needs.
I was really shocked. I was on a farm near Rehoboth, and it's very, very dry. And that farmer has game on his farm. And this morning, the morning we drove and we gave the game. And I was like shocked, and I was, okay, so now they ate everything and it's all gone. And when do you have to feed them again? He said, no, again. And how much is a bag? It's shocking how expensive fodder is. But Namibians make plans. I think we are very innovative people. So we, when we met at the biomass fair, then we see what they, what can be done to make fodder. From trees and from shrubs and from leaves.
We have that problem of bush
encroachment.
We can turn it into an opportunity. In fact, we have the knowledge now. In any case, I would always advise farmers, or advise farmers to have storage facilities for their animal fodder. So build a small storage compartment somewhere, or a small house, can be with corrugated sheets or whatever you, what you can afford, so that at least you buy supplements and store them. Stock up. Not always buying and feed directly to the animals. So it's better to stock up your storage, and then you feed from your storage. So you need to create that triangle. Shop, your storage, your crop.
And then feed.
And again, in terms of feeding animals, these products are different. They are those that are meant for production, and they are those that are meant for maintenance. You also need to know them. Some animals need to be just maintained, just that they survive until the next rainy season. There are those that I can say they are in office. That time they are producing. It's maybe they are pregnant or they are lactating. Some are on leaf, like the dry cow.
Some are on leaves.
So you need to protect your core producing unit or head. Yeah, make sure that they continue producing, because remember, there's again a plan after drought.
Erastus, thank you very much. I appreciate. I hope all the farmers will listen and take heart of all your valuable tips. Thank you very much.
Much welcome. So farmers are welcome to consult as well.
Thank you. Please. This man is sharp. For all your advice, contact Erastus Ngaruka at AgriBank.
Thank you.
Dagboek. Die Gobabis Landbouskou vind vanaf 26 tot 28 September by die Gobabis Kougronde plaas. Die slagoskompetisie vind donderdag vanaf 8:00 tot 12:00 plaas en vanaf 14:30 tot 5:00 die middag word die beesrasse Brahman, Angus en Sussex beoordeel. Vrydag vanaf 8:30 tot 14:30 die middag word die Brownview en Charolais beesrasse beoordeel. En Saterdag vanaf 8:00 vind die Interras beoordeling plaas. Nog 'n hoogtepunt is die tentoonstelling van die Sky Arabierperde Vrydag om 11:00 die oggend. Vrydag aand kan daar lekker litte losgemaak en geskoffel word by die skoudans. Die skou vind al sedert 1963 by Gobabis plaas. AgriMonitor gaan dit ook bywoon. Moenie dit misloop nie. Ons sien julle daar. Veilings, 17 September, vanavond om 6 uur, hou Agra hul nationale Beefmaster veiling in Windhoek by die Agra Ring. 18 September, Swakara Teelers Genootskap Ramveiling word op Keetmans Hoop gehou. Dit vind om 11 uur plaas. Om 10 uur is Hou Blouberg 'n grootveeveiling op Grootfontein en Windhoek Livestock Auctioneers 'n grootveeveiling by Nomtsas. 19 September, WLA hou 'n grootveeveiling by in Windhoek om 10 uur. 20 September, Blouberg hou 'n grootveeveiling op Wilhelmstal om 10 uur. En Agra se pluimvee en eksotiese voëlveiling vind in Windhoek plaas die middag om 3:30. Ook van Agra is die tweede jaarlikse Mutilus Bonsmara en Elofveiling ook by die Agra Ring in Windhoek om 3:30 die middag. 24 September, Namibia Livestock Auctioneers hou 'n groot en klein veeveiling by Monica om 10 uur en ook om 10 uur is WLA se klein veeveiling by Reobot. 25 September, NLA hou 'n groot en klein veeveiling by Aranos en WLA 'n groot veeveiling by Hoogveld. Albei veilings is om 10 uur die oggend. Vleispryse per kilogram op veilings. Tolly se pryse is op en gaan nou vir 31 Namibiese dollar 29 sent. Dieselfde met verse beloop nou $26 54 sent. Stoorosse se pryse is ook op en staan nou op $28 61 sent. Stoorverse se pryse is af en gaan nou vir $25 81. Dieselfde met slagosse, slagverse en slagbulle. Slagosse se pryse is nou $29 21 sent. Slagverse $27 1 sent. Slagbulle $26 21 sent. Koeie se pryse, dit is nou van maart tot vetkoeie, is op en gaan nou vir tussen $20 34 sent en $29 49 sent. Die prys van koeie met kalvers per kop is ook op en staan nou op $13,350. Bokke per kop se pryse is af en beloop nou $1,169. Slagskaap se pryse is op. Dorpers en vetstert slagskape gaan nou vir $32 30 sent. Die Bloemvelde Boerevereniging het onlangs hul 50ste bestaansjaar vrolik gevier. Nou dit is omtrent 'n mylpaal en ek is baie trots om te sê my oupa Ras Crawford en sy broer Dirk was van die stigterslede van die Bloemvelde Boerevereniging. So ons speel uit met 'n video van hul hoogtepunte oor 50 jaar. Geniet dit. Mooi week verder en tot sins. Onlangse vergadering tussen die Namibiese Lewende Hawe Produsente Organisasie LPO, die Suid-Afrikaanse Rooi Vleisprodusente Organisasie en die Gansieboerevereniging van Botswana is belangrike sake oor die veebedryf rakende die drie lande bespreek. Feedmaster Namibia het die 21 finaliste aangewys wat by die Windhoekskou beeste gaan beoordeel. Dit is nie net die Windhoekskou wat om die draai is nie, maar op die dagboek is ook die Gobabis Landbouskou. Bladsy 4 is propvol toerisme en omgewingsnuus met Noiras wat 'n gesogte internasionale wyntoekenning ontvang het. Daar is ook goeie nuus oor 'n olifantkalfie in die Hoop rivier. En die Bloemvelde Boerevereniging het omtrent hul 50ste bestaansjaar vrolik gevier.
'n Boodskap van Tersia van Skalkwyk namens Gerrit van Skalkwyk.
Die behoefte om 'n boerevereniging te begin het in 1973 op 'n saterdag namiddag tydens 'n gereelde tennisbijeenkomst by die tennisbane te Bloemvelde ontstaan. Op 27 Februarie 1974 is Bloemvelde Boerevereniging gestig. Om fondse te bekom is veilings in tydelike opgerigte krale gehou. Die dames het sonder enige geriewe eetgoed aan ons verskaf. Soos fondse beskikbaar was, is daar aankope gedoen vir die bou van die saal en die oprig van krale en 'n afdak. Die saal is gebou en die inwyding het plaasgevind op 23 Mei 1984. Later is dit verbreek en verander volgens behoefte geïdentifiseer. Ons pragtstuk van 'n naambord was die handewerk van Jannie de Beer. Sake soos bijvoorbeeld paaie, telefone, poswese, manpower en selfone was belangrike punte op die agenda en is komitee saamgestel om die sake te behartig. So is daar ook 'n radio en 'n misdaadklap gestig. Bome is geplant met ons 20-jarige viering. Gereelde bijeenkomste soos boeredae, afsluitingsfunksies, sportdae ensovoorts was gehou om lede bymekaar te bring om sosiaal te verkeer. Dames was altyd baie betrokke en kon later as bylede aansluit. 50 suksesvolle jare in die bestaan van Bloemvelde Boerevereniging is te wyte aan harde werk en betrokkenheid deur voorsitters, bestuurslede en alle boereverenigingslede. Ons dank en waardering aan almal en mag daar nog 50 suksesvolle jare wees.